Hello, and thank you for joining our webinar today, Building Hiring Manager Trust, What You Need to Know. My name is Jessica Alberto, and I sit as the Director of Process and Implementation at PeopleScience, and I'll be your moderator for the next hour. You'll find that these webinars are more conversational between our panel of guests. So at any point during today's discussion, if you'd like to include something or ask us a question, please use the Q&A box at the bottom of your Zoom screen, and we'll do our best to make sure that we get back to you. So let's move on to our panel of experts. As always, our webinar presenter today is Christine Nicholas, founder and CEO of PeopleScience and HireGate. PeopleScience has partnered with many human resource and TA departments over the last 26 years, including Fortune 100 companies, as well as startups, in developing and executing recruitment strategies, enhancing recruitment process improvements, and creating solutions to the toughest recruitment challenges. And on to our special guest this month, Charlene Zantis, Senior Director of Talent Acquisition at the American Red Cross. Charlene is responsible for building a strategic, scalable, and inclusive talent acquisition team with a passion for recruiting diverse top talent to the organization. In 2023, her team hired over 8,000 new employees to the Red Cross. Prior to joining the American Red Cross in 2012, Charlene was a talent manager with a financial services organization for more than 20 years. In that role, Charlene primarily supported recruitment efforts in the retail and commercial business units for that firm. So welcome, Charlene. We're so happy to have you with us today.
Thank you. I'm happy to be here.
Yes. And with that, Christine, I'll hand it over to you to get started.
I am always happy to see Charlene. Thank you so much for joining. And just so much great information that we've had in our conversation. So that's why I was really excited. I think it took me a while to get you on, but I'm glad that you're here today. So as always, we'll start with some of the stats that are most important to us. And we're actually just maybe we can pull those up. I'm going to go through these quickly. You know, somebody commented on a TikTok that I did over the weekend and said, these stats are boring because they don't change. Well, that's really good when it comes to employment when it's doing as well as it is. And as you know, we're living in this economy that we've never seen before. And finally, we're starting to see some articles in the press that are saying, you know, this is not the same up, down, recession, and bang and boom economy. And so much of that is based on the other indicators kind of staying the same, but employment really rocking the boat. Shout out to my friends from 20 years ago. We're like five of us that kept saying, if we don't fix talent acquisition, it's going to start to dictate our economy. And now we're seeing that the good, the bad, and the ugly. As I go over these, I just want to be sensitive to our HR people that are on the horn now, or anybody on the horn that is unemployed. It's never easy to see, oh, employment looks really good and you aren't working, right? That's just a terrible feeling. But it's also good news, right? Because it means things are coming around. And I will tell you, I have seen an incredible uptick in human resources and talent acquisition and recruiter positions in the last month. I don't think you're going to see it reflected just yet in these kind of metrics, but I think in the next 2 months, we're going to see that come back up. So unemployment rates, whether or not you love this number or judge it, I know, you know, it might look like there's a lot of up and down. This is really not much, right? 3.5 to 3.8. I think we're interested to see, curious that it came down, right? It came up a little bit and came down. And this is, look at the history here. That's what's going on. Not much movement. This is actually a very, very stable unemployment rate and probably one of the longest running unemployment rates we've seen. You know, just we should look at that and see this stability, if it is in fact like the longest we've seen it stay in the same kind of range. Okay, next number. So this is national job opening. So these are job openings. This is pulled, all of this information came from the Bureau of Labor Statistics. I always, you know, encourage you if you're interested to take a deeper dive, but I pull these because it is of interest to me and it's not an easy site to use. But you'll see that, again, this is pretty significant, right? Coming into the pre-pandemic, like coming into 2019, we were hovering around 7,200 job openings. We're still high up there at 8,800. And notice it's, here we go again. Look at the stability since November. Mm-hmm. So, you know, do we always want an economy that goes up and down, or do we want it stable enough? I think one of the big pluses of stability is it's allowing, and Charlie, maybe you can chime in, it's allowing us in talent acquisition to say, where are our root challenges? Because we're not going up and down. We don't urgently need somebody, and that, oh, we don't need somebody. You know, but right. Is it really the highs and the lows? Is the stability working for you as far as planning is concerned?
Yeah, it does work for us because it gives us an opportunity to take a look at the trends and prepare for when we know that it's going to possibly have an uptick. But it also gives our team, the talent advisors, an opportunity to really, look at their overall client groups, work with the hiring managers in more, robust ways. Because they're in that steady state where there's not so much urgency. So we do take advantage of this time just to allow us to plan and really focus on trends.
Plan is the operative word. Great. One more note on this. So there right now, based on the unemployment rate, there is 1.3 jobs for every person on unemployment. And again, not news going back 10 years ago, we knew coming into this and in 2019, it was becoming more evident. Now we have even, more proof of that, but it's the disparity in the type of talent that we have available and the type of jobs. So that's part of it. Okay. This is national added and lost. So we added 303,000 again, ahead of projections. I think the feds, certainly the markets were saying, okay, it's coming down. It's going to keep coming down, right? January was a surprise. You're like, oh, it was a fluke. It went down to 275,000. Now it's back up to 303. So here we go again. Right? The our companies and what our organizations are doing and the kind of talent that they're trying to find and the way they're trying to piece this together are really dictating where the economy is and overall is going. Jess, did I give you the breakout or I didn't? Because I think, again, being sensitive to those who aren't working, here it is, right? Okay, so this is what's up, and this is their average. So if we look at healthcare hiring, so job openings in healthcare are 70K a month, they're usually 60. So that was up 10K. Mm-hmm. Government, 71,000 jobs, it's usually 54. Construction, 37, it's usually 19. Leisure and hospitality, 49, it's usually 37. That, by the way, is the largest number that we've had since COVID, which was a little surprising to me. I think that we're seeing leisure and hospitality come back, the evidence of that in the first quarter and second quarter of this year. Other services, which is where pieces of IT, this is not a category, but they categorized it this way, is 16,000. So that's pretty much knowledge workers that aren't captured in these other pieces. So that's a big array, right? So that's IT, that's HR, that's TA, usually runs averages about 8K, is actually up 16. That's good news. It's good news for IT, who's taken a big hit in the last year, and good news for TA too. Social assistance, 9,000, so they're down from their 22, and retail at 18, down a little bit from their 20K. So you guys don't have to send me all these comments, like what happened in my space? I'm hoping that this help covers it and helps you have a little better feeling about where your industry is going. If you want more information on this, it is at the Bureau of Labor Statistics, and you can look at your own profession and see where you are. All right. So
interesting.
People, to geeks like me, it's interesting. But I think it's important that we know that in talent acquisition, because can you imagine like being able to walk into your CFO's office and say, hey, did you see the JOLTS report last month? And just make them sit up on their chair as we start to really try to elevate TA and just knowing nothing. Is it going to trickle down to your specific job? I think as Charlene talks today and we talk about building that trust and learning the business, that these are key ingredients that can really be helpful in creating your own credibility. If it doesn't, if it doesn't disseminate to the job you're working on or you're in your specific industry, it does trickle down when it comes to building your own, So, for diversity and inclusion, for the last 3 months, I've been complaining because I've seen budgets cut. I've seen positions taken away. And I've realized, though, as we've been talking to some of our government friends, so some of our organizations that are regularly operated, our clients that are regularly operated. So if you do business with the government or you're a government entity, we're actually seeing an uptick in the demand for diverse hiring, for sticking to their guns and making that happen. Having been a part of this with a regulating operating board of New Jersey for the Board of Public Utilities, that has been a very, very long road. And COVID really did tick it up. What I'm happy to see is the government entities that are holding their feet to the fire, those servicing them are too. And they have not, that I can see, done too much to their budgets. In fact, maybe even increasing them. So, woo-hoo. Excuse me. If you're regulated, I'd like to hear from you on that. So what are you seeing and hearing in your own organization or other organizations about our key diversity people within our organizations? Are you, and your initiatives, are you getting funding? So good news there. A topic that we get a lot of requests from at People Science amongst our clients and amongst just other interested people is, you know, when we look at diversity, what is going on with ageism? And I think, you know, AARP in particular has done a lot of publications about this, but it is a really, really real thing. And it's everywhere. And, you know, social media is really great, but I think that it's creating, in my opinion, a bigger divide. When we talk about generations in the workforce, and we say, well, you know, Gen X, Gen Y, Gen Z, boomers, it has the propensity to go south really fast. Like Gen X or Gen, you know, how did Gen X, they keep saying, why is Gen X not getting thrown under the bus? And like, because we weren't allowed, you know, we had to drink from the water hose outside. We were never given treats. We were never coddled. We were never able to do these things. There's a lot of finger pointing that goes on. And I think that that is really pushing this narrative, which the irony is, every poll globally and especially in the U.S. says that diversity is a hot topic, especially to Gen Z, Gen Y, all the new generations coming up. Yet those generations in particular tend to have a really big voice about, and they created the saying, okay, boomer. So it's like, where does this stop? Like, is an insult considered harmful? And, you know, how does that affect things? And I think with ageism in particular, we're seeing, you know, we're seeing that grow even more so. And I don't see how that can't trickle into the interview process and internal confrontations and separations. Any thoughts around that?
Well, I think it definitely goes both ways too, right? You also have the older generations thinking that the younger generations don't want to work, or there's the quiet quitting, there's the lazy girl jobs. That's kind of filtered into other thoughts and those things. So I really do think, again, just going back to the basics, having a recruiter in the seat working with the hiring manager that's focused on what's the outcome for this position, what's required of it, what are we looking for, and then focusing on candidates that have those attributes. Even, you know, maybe taking some of those identifiers off of resumes, years of, you know, when did you graduate from school, if they've been working extensively, maybe just putting down where they work, not specifically listing out the years. So it's really hard to identify how long has this person been working. So you can kind of get rid of some of those biases from the start. But I think, again, having that hiring manager recruiting relationship set in place and the recruiter acting as an advisor to avoid some of those compliance and bias issues is a good start.
And the discrimination itself is illegal. I think I was surprised because I delved into this a little bit more. You know, it's not illegal to ask in the interview if somebody's age. It actually is not illegal. Now, the ramifications, right? You don't want to make that a best practice for sure. And you want to make sure that you prep your HMs about that. But the amount of, so here's the numbers from the EEOC. The number of court filings made under the Age Discrimination Act, the ADEA, in the fiscal year of 2023 was more than double of 2022. I think that goes along with what we're hearing, that boomers want to stay in the market longer and they want to know if they're not getting a job because of their age. You know, and I think there's a fine line between the jokes that we hear and the terms that are coined and how hurtful it becomes. Because, you know, I don't know about you, Charlene and Jess, but people, in my opinion, and I had an attorney tell me this a long time ago, a discrimination attorney, like, people sue because of how they feel. And if you feel like you've been turned down for a job or not even interviewed because of your age, that it's hurtful. And that's, I think, what starts to evoke that. And if you don't know, you know, which so often we go into that dark hole. If you don't, was it my age? Why didn't I get the interview? Why didn't I get there? if we try to keep that in mind and these protected classes, and that ageism is a protected class, maybe we can get better at it. Mm-hmm. Cool. So what is going on in the return to workspace? Someone said the other day, they don't get why people don't understand. This was so, as Desiree Mingo, who's she's actually joining our Workday group, Charlene. I've known her for years. She's in HR. And she said to me something about, if you were hired and you knew you had to come into the office, why are you surprised when there's not a pandemic that you should come into the office? And that blew me away. Because I got to say, I've always been on the opposite side of the fence. But what a valid point. Thank you, Desiree. Mm-hmm. I didn't look at it that way. Do you ever think of it that way? I know you guys are remote too, but.
Yeah. No, and at one point I had learned from, I had heard, I forget who I heard this from, but it was sort of the same way. Is in the beginning, if you are expected to come to work, there's certain business groups and certain organizations that have to have you back in the office. And so if it's set from the very beginning, your employee experience, your onboarding about you need to be in the office, then it should not be a challenge coming back to the office. However, with that being said, you know, the work environment and the labor market has changed and the expectation from the employee has changed. So I think there should be some flexibility. There needs to be flexibility and understanding so the businesses can hear from and understand what their employees are saying and what's important to them. So that's just sort of my take on it.
Well, and I think we had such a mind shift, right?
Yes, we did.
I think in that statement, the word unfair, right? Because when you look at the noise around this, like, why do I have to go back to work? By the way, Desiree's company does do a hybrid situation. They're not demanding anybody come in.
Yeah.
You know, I think when I talked to her about this further, what she was saying is it's not an unfair practice. Right. Mm-hmm. Like, you feel like you're being treated unfairly because you have to go back into the office. Is it really unfair? If you try to look at it from the company's perspective, too, is it really unfair? And I think it's up to us as employers to say, poll your audience, poll your employees. Right. What do they really think? And how much can we afford to lose to quiet quitting? How much can we afford to lose, period, with people leaving because we can't be flexible? And do we know what those are? Mm-hmm. I think it's also interesting how many companies haven't drawn the line in the sand yet. How many stop and starts are out there? We're all in, we're half in, 3 days a week. It keeps changing. And Danielle DiLiberto will be joining us not next month, the month after that, to talk about, she's working on this right now. And she's working on it in Manhattan, which is even, if you base everything on Manhattan, you get the worst. It's like, you know, New York and California give us the two biggest extremes. So I think that's going to be good. But right now, commercial real estate is down 20% across the country. So that tells us that hybrid models and remote is here to stay. New York City is saying that the Manhattan office market is in demand high, is very high demand. Like, the classification is high. They always say that. They've never not said that. I don't know who puts those numbers together, but it's kind of across the board. But they are saying that the rents are lower and the terms are lower. So the amount of time that you have to commit to is also lower. So on that note, our next headline, and then we'll get right into the topic, is the balance of employee-employer relationship in the new world of work. So just some interesting stats. Millennials make up 50% of the workforce, but by 2030, they'll be 75% of the workforce. So if you're not paying attention, you need to pay attention, right? 92% of millennials say that the recognition of their accomplishments by senior staff and colleagues is very important or important. So they had those two categories in there, 92%. I mean, I'm kind of thinking, is that really a millennial thing? And that's like an everybody thing, but good to know. 21% of millennials say they've changed jobs in the past year. That's a pretty hefty number. And millennials are 22 times more likely to stay with a company that cultivates trust, which is a great segue into the hiring manager's trust. So, Charlene, tell us about your work at ARC, what you guys, you know, how big your team is. And I know you've had some really cool initiatives this year.
Yeah, we did. Yeah, so let me just give you a high-level overview about the Red Cross, because I don't think folks really understand the amount of work that we do outside of just a blood organization, right? So we have over 18,000 employees with 200,000 volunteers. So we're a pretty large organization, and our employees and volunteers are considered pretty much equal. They truly are volunteers, really are the backbone of our organization. And we have several mission services. We call it mission services, what essentially is our lines of service, which you consider, we have disaster and international services, where that is our business that helps families and communities. And then we also have services to the armed forces. We have a significant amount of employees and volunteers that support the military, particularly when they are in significant need of help. Even with our veterans, we've done a lot when we've had disasters and going in and helping our veterans as much as we can, particularly in areas that have been affected by the disaster. Also, we have training services, which, believe it or not, we train over 4.9 million folks every year, people every year for CPR training and also lifeguard training. So that's also one of our bigger businesses. And then our biomedical services, that's our biggest business. That's where our blood, we are one of the biggest blood supplies in the, you know, in the nation. So that is like, you know, we go in and we serve the hospitals, and that is the most critical thing that we can provide. And then also just enterprise services. We have a lot of corporate. We have the typical corporate functions, believe it or not. So we do have the average corporate functions, which my team supports all of those lines of services that I, you know, just talked about. And I think, Jessica, as you said in the beginning, we fill about 8,000 positions a year, 7,000 to 8,000 positions a year. And we have done a lot of work around supporting our mission. That's how my team really stays motivated, is they recognize that they are adding value to the mission. Because, and I know even with people science, Christine, your recruiters understand, because you support us so well, that if there is a low blood supply and we have a significant amount of openings, it's recognized that we need to get the staff in very quickly in order to run our blood drives. So it's just, we see how we are connected to the mission. This year, we have the opportunity to send talent advisors over to Maui to support the wildfires. They had a huge hiring goal in Maui, and we needed to go there and support the business and hire folks in on land there in Maui. So it really gave my team an opportunity to experience the mission and work with hiring managers on site, and being able to support those managers and get employees on pretty quickly. So that's just sort of overall about the Red Cross. I started with the Red Cross back in 2012. And when I got here, we essentially, the TA staff had just been pulled out of a decentralized model. The recruiters were out in very different parts of the business. They didn't necessarily report directly into HR, like a TA COE. So we centralized the TA function. And so when I got here, we had a pretty well, new team that was centralized, and we were building out what was going to make the impact and how we were going to support the business in talent acquisition, because again, we have so many vacancies all over the place. So the first thing that I actually did is I started up the fundraising recruiting team, and that's where I was able to work very closely with my team and get them to understand how critical it was to get to know what the fundraising business was, because the only way that they were going to be successful was that if they understood what fundraising did and how they were going to be able to attract the right candidate to the organization. So it was all about building relationships with hiring managers in the business and also understanding their business objectives. So at this point in 2019, we went through a full HR transformation, and we truly are a COE now within the talent management, within the HR space. So we have great reputation and relationships with managers at all levels. It really starts at the C-suite, quite frankly, to build out trust with hiring managers. Because think about it, leaders in the organization, they're going to have a opening at some point in time. You have staff, you're going to have a vacancy. So the CHRO is it's a critical piece in order to start to build that relationship within the business, because you've got to understand the business objectives. You need to understand the workforce strategies. And once the CHRO is able to get that relationship solid, it really does trickle down into the HR function, particularly in TA, when you start recruiting for hiring managers that are really on the line and are, you know, out there really doing the work. So, Christine, is there anything else you want me to elaborate? I can talk a little bit about building effective relationships and what it takes to, you know, what is the successful collaboration with the hiring manager? But did you have any comments or questions about what I said?
Well, you know, the first thing that I was writing down is this thing, it hasn't been around, it hasn't been used in a couple of years, in my opinion, just-in-time hiring, right?
Yeah.
To me, just-in-time hire is like a high volume that needs to be done right away. It's pressing. So you talk to a retail store and it's so important, you know, you can't not have somebody think. If ARC's just-in-time hiring isn't there, there's not enough blood.
Right.
I mean, that's pretty serious. If the just-in-time hiring isn't in place, then the Hawaii fires may not go the way they're supposed to, you know, the way you're planning them. They're really life-saving events. And I think in our experience working with ARC, the one thing that we've noticed is that trickles into the culture. Like you said, you're in disaster mode all the time. First of all, we know from studies that we've done with recruiters, that's exhausting on your adrenals, right? Like as a person constantly in this, just got to fill. That's like what you do and what you're compensated to do and what you bring to the world is this disaster relief. So, you know, you've got to have these teams that are disaster ready to recruit, disaster ready to understand what a disaster is and to work in this culture where everything is kind of a fire. And then once the fire's out, does it ever calm down, Charlene? Does it ever back down? Or are you always like, you know, there's going to be another disaster around the corner?
Yeah, we know that there could potentially be another disaster, but disaster season, there is, you know, a point in time that we know that disaster season, we prep for disaster season, right? So right now we're sort of dwindling down from disaster season, and then we're going to start to see an uptick in the next couple of months, right? But then also when you think about, we know that there's certain, outside of just disaster, we know that there's certain months that the blood supply could potentially get low. It's during the summer when folks go on vacation. Like right now, that's why we're sort of steady state on the blood side, because we know that folks they donate around this time. There's pretty much pretty good donations around this time. And then it starts to slow down during the summer, and then it could uptick again, and then it slowed down again around the holidays. So that's when you start, that's the strategy that my team and my leaders have to really think about, so that we know that we're prepared during those times of the year, so that we can staff pretty quickly when we need to.
Yeah, and that's what I'm saying. I think one of the things that I've noticed is how buttoned up ARC is. And, you know, it's that old adage too. Like if you ask a person how organized they are and they tell you a 10, that means they're not organized, because people who think that organized or that prepared are going to say, oh, I'm a 5 because I can always get better. And I don't think until we've been working with you, we realize the sophistication of your thought process.
Yeah.
And so humble about it. I mean, and I think that's a huge part. And to be honest too, the recruiters who we have assigned, they get the purpose, right?
Yeah.
But your recruiters too, your TA team, it's so embedded in them.
Yes.
You know? Do you think that your own, and your not just your TA turnover, but how do you feel about the turnover at ARC? And do you think that the relationship with the hiring manager affects that?
Oh, 100%. I think that the turnover, you know, Our blood services, Biomed, does have pretty high turnover because those are entry level, high, you know, turnover positions. And we actually have a culture initiative going on right now within donor services to really help build out and change in some of the culture, because we need to be able to, do better in terms of our retention. So it does start directly at the hiring manager level. You've got to be able to, it also relates to your EVP, right? Your EVP is one of the most critical things you have to be able to have the manager engaged in, because it is going to, the recruiter really engages with the hiring manager from the very beginning. And they're selling the role, they're talking about the benefits of why somebody should come and work here. And then the candidate is also talking with the hiring manager. And if the hiring manager continues to hold on to that candidate once we make an offer and increase and ensure that their onboarding is the best employee experience, that you're going to be able to hold on to those folks, right? So it really does start with the recruiter, and then it's sort of passed on to the manager and taught and really focused on the culture and the employee experience from what we talked about in the job market.
And then even in front of that, I think is, mm-hmm. you know, and we're going to go through some steps that we've seen. And the reason that we're doing this today is because there is such a big correlation between knowing the hiring manager, aligning with the hiring manager, and the success. Yes. We also see across the board that that's one of the biggest bottlenecks in talent acquisition. A lot of finger pointing. When we come in as an RPO, there's almost always this finger pointing.
Yes.
Didn't do this. The mm-hmm. agents never get back to me. There's all this fragmentation that goes on. A lot of that has to do with not having the data. But I think the importance, and maybe you can speak to how you, I know you just went through a transition period with this where, and my friend Deb Kroger, who's going to be on next month, she said to me, well, you know, the thing is, you don't even have to know your hiring manager. You have to know the business first. Because mm-hmm. if you know the business and you understand what the business does, then the hiring manager cares about you.
Yes.
And I think so often in TA, it's more like, I got the job description. I got you what you wanted. Why didn't you tell me you needed that? This isn't working because of that. And then, you know, the sediment goes down. If you understand the business, you're not, and we've seen many instances where understanding the business puts TA in a position where they're not just bringing candidates for that rec. They're also saying, hey, here's a candidate with this kind of learned knowledge in the profession. Right.
Yes.
So,
about it goes to that's why I was saying that when I came on and I was in charge of fundraising, it was for me and my team to really get to understand what the fundraising business did so we can bring the right candidates into them. It's not just about hiring somebody that has fundraising experience. If somebody has a sales profile or they have a certain profile, we should be able to consider that candidate. But again, the only way we were going to be able to do that is to really get to understand the business and the job and understand their needs and their work with the hiring manager. It really, you've got to take the time to understand the hiring manager's requirement, not just the hiring manager's requirements in terms of the job description, but also the team dynamics. It's the culture. You've got to be able to find a candidate that's a good fit versus somebody that's just qualified, right? So the first piece of being able to build that relationship is getting to understand the business, getting to understand their needs, and also getting to understand the work so that you can profile the correct candidate. Another big piece, I think, with building and gaining trust from the hiring manager and building relationships is communication. Being able to communicate clearly and regularly is one of the most critical components of the job, because oftentimes we hear, I haven't heard from the recruiter in 2 weeks. I haven't heard from the recruiter in 3 weeks. I had my, you know, intake session, you know, 4 weeks ago, and I haven't gotten an update. So really being able to establish open lines of communication and keeping hiring managers updated during the recruitment process is so critical. And also be transparent about challenges. I think in talent acquisition, we tend to not want to be transparent about, I haven't been able to find a candidate. It's been challenging to, you know, source that the right person is not coming up. But if you're transparent and honest and you're open about it, your hiring manager is going to just trust and you're going to be able to build the relationship even deeper. And it's just really those regular check-ins, even when you don't have a candidate, is one of the most critical components.
Yeah. And I think, like, take your hiring manager to lunch. Jess, I know you're going to go over some of these bullet points for us, but just like you would if you were servicing anybody else. And I think, you know, I think the broader picture here in talent acquisition is that there's different skill sets, right?
Yeah.
And some recruiters have a high confidence level and they have no problem speaking to a business lead, where others don't. And I think knowing your talent team and saying, can I uplift and train this person so that they can do that? And if I can't, can I augment them with someone who can?
Yes.
I'm kind of giving away some people's own secret sauce, but that's how we do it, right? Like, and by the way, we can drop a link. We'll drop a link into this and maybe send it out with our follow-up, Jess, to the talent sets. But building that relationship isn't for everybody. I mean, we have heads down bullion string experts that use every kind of sourcing device mm-hmm. out there that really should not enter. They need the information, but they're not the one that's going to keep the relationship going with the hiring manager. Mm-hmm. That mm-hmm. is somebody different. So I think understanding your own team and not expecting, you know, the fish to climb the tree, right? Like, if that's not mm-hmm. your skill set, we shouldn't try to force you into it. But I also think that when we take the time to do that, we're elevating our profession in their mm-hmm. eyes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Nobody likes to get bad news, is what I'm saying.
Yeah.
So yeah. The way you do that is by having a relationship where they trust, if they trust you, then, and you trust them, you can have these open conversations that lead to good
jobs. Yeah. And also, you need to be able to provide insight and feedback. You know, you, when you're presenting your candidates, you've got to be able to offer your professional assessment and insights. I think this really helps the hiring managers, and it informs the hiring managers about the candidate pool that they're getting. I think oftentimes, especially nowadays, particularly on the volume, we just send candidates over in an email and we're like, okay, here, I want you to interview these four folks, and haven't really provided insight. That's why I always think it's critical you have a summary, some type of summary, or even conversation during your regular update meetings about the candidate. You need to be able to have that conversation so the manager can decide who they want to be able to interview. You're suggesting it, but it's ultimately the hiring manager's decision on how who they're going to interview and who they end up hiring. So providing insightful feedback is also one of the most critical pieces in building the trust with hiring managers.
And I think one of the biggest blockades to that is the amount of time it takes to do a recap to send them. And through our relationship with ARC, we were able to update our own technology. So where it was taking to do an overview of a candidate, right? Because if the candidate doesn't fit the exact resume, like, what? And the hiring manager's like, I've done this myself.
Right.
Like, I have to meet this person. Why am I looking at this, right? So with today's AI, whether you're using our system or you're not, you can use AI to easily create those. We're now saving about 4 hours a week in recruiters mm-hmm. time because they're able to use this tool to create this, at least the framework for the overview. And then they just fine tune it. And sometimes if they want to use even more language, they'll put it in ChatGPT and out it goes.
Yeah.
Where the same thing might have taken 20 minutes to get it right, to get it in front of them.
Yeah.
But I do see a correlation with all of our accounts where the relationship with the hiring manager is such that I'm not going to question what Jess sent me because I know Jess, she told me to see this candidate, I've got to see them, right? I mean, that's the premier relationship we all want to get to.
But yeah, absolutely.
Use AI.
Also,
I would say that to the audience. Use AI. Stop, you know, struggling to write for hours. Again, you know, you might be putting a fish in a tree. I'm not a good writer, but I'm a good recruiter. Yeah, use these AI tools to help you get there.
Absolutely. And it's a time saver, right? It's sort, you know, to be able to get things over to the manager in a timely manner. But also, I think another piece is being a strategic partner with your hiring manager and go beyond the transactions aspects of recruitment, right? You want to be able to offer strategic advice on talent acquisition. And I know that not all of our talent advisors are in that space. That's really where sometimes as your leaders and you maybe more of your senior level talent advisors should, what they should be doing. But I do think it's important for talent advisors to be able to stay up on market trends. It's so easy to be able to pull the info that you just pulled, you know, Christine, being able to make sure they understand it, attend webinars like this, right? So that they can learn and develop their own skills. And also, it's critical that we talk about succession planning with our hiring managers, because as a strategic partner, you need to be able to, you're typically assigned to the same hiring manager on a consistent basis. So if you understand succession planning, it allows you to be proactive as a talent advisor and understand what's going to be coming to your desk and what potentially could be going internally. And it's not something that you necessarily need to start thinking about as a recruiter. And also the hiring manager would consider you as a valuable resource when you think about it from a strategic standpoint. You're not just a service provider. And that's what I try to have my TA managers communicate with talent advisors. You're not just a service provider. You are a consultant. You're an advisor. And in order to really gain that trust and be partner, you need to be able to ensure that you're speaking about these things with them. So it is critical to be a partner. A strategic partner.
And when you look at recruiters that are recruiting for senior level positions, the turnover in that space is lower. A lot of times they opt to go into their own executive search firm. But, you know, and that's a practice, but and it's almost all by word of mouth. And that is because the trust is there. You understand me. You understand the way I think. You understand the business. So I want you with me. And I think the misnomer is when you're doing high volume work, you can't really do that. When, you know, I'm not like you. You know, we were talking to somebody yesterday who's, their recruiters are in the IT space and they're used to thinking in terms of IT. No, this is something that's effective no matter what the skill level, you know, it's not this, it's a misnomer to say it only works with senior level. It's really, really important. And I think the businesses themselves don't understand the importance of it. When you know, disseminate into entry-level positions or high-volume positions.
Right, yeah.
Jess, tell us about some of the checklists that we have put together on things that you can do to build these relationships.
Yeah, well, I think one of the first things to have your recruiters doing, having been a recruiting manager for a little bit, is really make sure that the recruiters have empathy for the hiring managers in the beginning. You know, hiring managers may have recently had a bad experience with recruitment. They're also probably in the hot seat because one of the positions in their team or department is empty. So they could be covering the work for that person. They could have concerns over why the last employer resigned. There's all these things going on in their head that we really need to have empathy for and understand. They don't do recruiting all day. Talent acquisition does that. So going in with that mindset, I think makes it a little bit easier to work with.
But and there's some good programs on that, like how to teach empathy in the workforce. Your bias training crisscrosses over.
Yeah.
Good one.
So in the beginning, I think when a recruiter begins working with a new hiring manager, really having well-defined goals and processes in place. So typically that begins with a kickoff or a launch call about the position. But making that call, you know, really have agreed upon SLA. So the recruiter saying, you know, this is when we expect to get candidates over to you. If you could please respond back to me within this amount of time to let me know your feedback. Having those goals in place and the hiring manager has a timeline so they know what to expect, again, kind of gives them an ease that things are being handled and worked on. And also that there's no confusion of who's doing what. And also in this time frame or period of the early recruiting stage, Charlene, like you said, you know, you're really setting what is the EVP for this position? What is the EVP for the department, the organization as a whole? And getting agreement between the recruiter and hiring manager on those types of things is super important because you want to make sure the recruiter's interviewing the same way the hiring manager is interviewing. And that goes all the way up to training and onboarding as well. So making sure everyone's on the same page with that is important.
And it changes a lot, right? So when we go in and do EVP work, so we go in and help organizations figure out what is my EVP, what's my employee value proposition. we start at the top and we say, what's the organization's EVP, right? And then how does that disseminate into this department? Mm-hmm. So what's the department's version of the larger EVP? And then what is the individual hiring manager's take on it? Where, you know, how are they affiliated to that? And then even all the way down, this is the job, you know, how it fits into the job. So it's not just a matter of having an EVP and being on the same board. It's understanding how specific it can get. You know, we've worked with organizations that their EVP is, you know, very kind, friendly, empathy, and then gotten down to a hiring manager that nobody wants to term, who's actually a carrot and stick person. Mm-hmm. And what we found is, Jess always makes that face when I say carrot and stick. I try not to judge them because we were able to help this fellow by finding people who like carrot and stick people. They're out there. Like, you know, and some people can only work in that atmosphere. So really understanding how it all trickles down and that it can be different with the hiring managers. And a lot of times I think that's where we see a fragment. The assumption is the company is this way, so the hiring manager thinks that way. And although there is that string of commonality that goes from the original EVP all the way down, it does, there's variations.
Absolutely. So then also the second piece would be, like Charlene mentioned as well, having that ongoing communication. This will make things run so much smoother and faster, setting those weekly check-in calls. You know, and most of the times you end up probably checking in daily as you're sending candidates over and getting feedback, but having something established where you review the candidates that are in place, you talk about challenges and solutions you may have, will really build that trust with the hiring manager. The communication, though, should also be effortless for the hiring manager. Finding out what form of communication they like. Do they want you to call them directly? Do they want you to text them? Are emails better? And then also as you're sending out those messages and communications, making sure that they're clear, they make sense, they're quick, they're easy to read for them, and they answer any questions that you may think that we'll have in the end.
The effortless experience.
Exactly.
Right.
Being easy to work with. You know, so many of these hiring managers, like we said, have they're doing their desk job or whatever their main focus is responsibility. So if they get an email from Jessica and there's no header or there's just a candidate's name, they won't know what it means if they're busy doing other things.
Yeah. What did you think of Alan yesterday?
Right. Exactly.
Did you like that resume I sent?
Yes. You'll get a faster response.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Or see the trailing email below and they're on their mobile going, oh my God. Like,
right.
Yeah. And I think there's kind of this power shift, right? But I think understanding that service is powerful and it's just as powerful. But I do think it relies on us on the TA side to do a lot of that effortless work because this is your client.
Mm-hmm. And I do think as recruiting leaders, as you're deciding who to put on specific requisitions or pair up with hiring managers, having, you know, a good sense of what their commonalities are helps too and will make communication a bit easier. Part of the communication piece is data and metrics. So having your recruiting leaders and your recruiters armed with the metrics as they go into these weekly update calls or check-ins with the hiring managers is important. But making sure that they're not just the vanity metrics, right? Making sure that they're metrics that are meaningful. So giving them insight into how many people were contacted this week? How many times does it take a recruiter to reach out, call, or text a candidate before they engage? And then also being able to look at skill sets of candidates and what is their availability in the market. So sometimes a hiring manager may be looking for someone that's very rare in a specific market. But if the recruiter comes armed with that data and can tell the story, the hiring manager is more apt to listen. Caveat with the data and the metrics, though, I'm not saying just throw metrics at a hiring manager and say, we've reached out to this many people this many times and nobody wants the position because they're declining it because of salary. Come to them with the data, but also have a solution to back it up. And you can go to your strategy team, your recruiting leadership and get that advice for them. But having data so you can understand what's happening, but also have it to give you insight and to come up with a solution and problem solve, hopefully before the hiring manager feels it. And then finally, and I know we talk about talent acquisition becoming advisors, but really having your recruiting team share your knowledge and skills with the hiring managers. So, you know, at People Science, we have client service managers that oversee the recruiting teams, and they specifically have expertise in the certain areas that they're recruiting in. So, for example, I've led a couple of manufacturing teams. I'm a little bit more well-versed in that area. My counterpart, Lindsay, is really strong in healthcare and high volume. So she really stays in tune with industry updates, networking associations, attending conferences, webinars in those specific industries. So being able to share that type of knowledge with your hiring managers and, you know, having them understand that you know the business, you understand what the outcomes and the goals should be, will really help build that trust and that working relationship.
You know, these points that Jess is bringing up, as the leader of TA, I mean, I think you've done a super job of empowering your team to do this. But I think what we see a lot is, and if you're a TA leader in here, you know, in the rush to make sure we fill the job, some of these really good practices, just you're not supporting, not only are we not educating recruiters on it, we're not supporting them. They've got such a workload that they can't even get to that. So right. You're making more fires for yourself by trying to put out the fire too quickly. Is that?
Yes. Yeah. And that's why I think it's important as a TA leader is to be able to have those one-on-one conversations with your recruiters and really look under the hood of what's going on with the vacancies. Pay attention to the vacancies that the recruiter has. Really ask your recruiter to be transparent and honest. You've got to build that trust with your recruiter too, to see where they are in terms of the, you know, what's happening with their job. Are they struggling? Is there something that you can, as a TA leader, provide some insight and give empathy to them, you know, show empathy to them as well, because they are on the front lines with the managers. Particularly when the volume is high, you've got to be able to lean in a little bit more as a TA leader so that you know what is going on and if there's any resources that need to be added to help boost some of the candidate pools.
Mm-hmm. One of the things that we do at People Science is called the Client Satisfaction Report. So everyone that's on a team that's supporting one of our RPO clients is tagged up with anyone on the client side, whether it's the hiring manager, the admin clerk that we work with, you know, the TA lead, vendor management. And what we do is we go through on a regular basis and grade the status of that hiring manager or stakeholder. The ultimate goal is to get them to be an advocate. So saying, I'd highly recommend you work with Jessica for recruiting. And so we go through each person that we work with at the client and, you know, grade them. And if they're not an advocate, we say, how can we get them to an advocate status? So it's something that we found really useful to make sure that one, our clients are happy and our hiring managers are happy, but also it's a good exercise to talk through with your recruiters to really get insight into what's going on and help them build relationships with the people they'll be recruiting for.
And I think I personally sit in on that once a month. And I think that encourages our team leads to put the importance at the forefront. When you're putting all these fires down, you're filling all these jobs, those kind of things can go to the wayside, and that's where it gets bumpy, right? So these are what Stephen Covey or the Eisenhower four quadrants would say are quadrant two things. They're not urgent, but they're really important. And sometimes, quite often in recruiting, they fall into, you know, the abyss. They don't even get addressed, which when you think of it, makes more things more urgent. So by giving the recruiters the time that they need to do that, acknowledging it, that it's important time, and just stealing a few minutes of their attention towards building those makes a big difference.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And a good example of this, we were recruiting for WL Gore, some of their light industrial positions at their Phoenix and Flagstaff locations, which were, the Flagstaff location was remote. So at the onset of the partnership, most of the hiring managers were really skeptical of partnering with an RPO. Many didn't want to engage. They wanted to engage with their local staffing agencies they already had personal relationships with. So they were hesitant to work with our recruiters. But, you know, we came in, we looked at their entire recruiting process from beginning to end. We were able to streamline processes for them, make things a little bit more effortless on the hiring manager side. and build those relationships. And, you know, they felt that we understood their recruiting market. We really learned what it was like to work at that remote site. So we were able to communicate that with the candidates and make sure they were the right fit. But at the, you know, end of our work, we were able to convert 18 out of 19 hiring managers into advocates for that partnership. So meaning, again, that they would recommend us to work with for hiring and anything talent acquisition related. So there's so much good work that can be done with building the hiring manager relationships if you put the proactive time and effort into it.
And I think, you know, being empowered to do it. Mm-hmm. You know, exactly. If we all worked for Charlene, it would be easier. So I think the other thing is, you know, we talked about this earlier, Justice, we'll make sure and put the talent sketch in there. But if your recruiter isn't there and you don't think that it would, they'd ever get to the point where they'd have the confidence to have that conversation, then tag team them with somebody who will. So we'll also put these bullet points in the follow-up. I know we're coming up on the hour. We did have a couple of questions. So let's get to the meat of those before we run out of time, Jess.
Sure. So someone asked advice on how to work best with global hiring managers who are very slow to respond, don't follow process, et cetera, despite your follow-up. I know one of the tools that we've used at PeopleScience, and you can find this on our website, is the cost of vacancy calculator. So it can tell you for how many days this position has been sitting empty, it's costing the company this much. So I think if you're having a hiring manager who just isn't really focused on getting a position filled, this is a good tool to show them, because they might not be thinking that way, right? So cost of vacancy calculator is something that could definitely be useful. And we can include a link in that to our follow-up email as well. But again, advice on that, making things easier for them. So sending them an email, you know, if you want to make a response, choose A, B, C, or D. So all they have to do is respond A. That could get a faster feedback. But really just learning what their communication preferences are can help with that as well. The other question we had is, what
also,
is the
one other thing, Jessica, sure. I can indicate too, is at the beginning, at the onset of the vacancy, is to set a SLA on communication, right? So let them know, you know, when you expect them to respond or what would work for them at the beginning of the vacancy, because that usually should, you know, create a better experience for you and for the manager.
Absolutely. I agree with you on that one, Charlene. So someone also asked, hiring managers who insist on many interviewers or panel interviews, even for junior roles. How do you handle that type of situation where your hiring manager wants, you know, 10 people to meet with a candidate, or they want 3 different meetings?
So for when we, particularly for junior roles, we talk about and ask the why in the beginning, really at the beginning stages, again, when you're doing the intake session, is you find out who is going to be part of the interview panel. And if there is an extensive amount of folks, you sort of ask the why, help me understand why there's so many. But then also that's a time for you to educate the manager on what it could potentially create in terms of, you know, the candidate experience and losing the candidate in today's market. So trying to come to a compromise and advise them on what you would recommend in terms of how many people should be interviewing.
And really doing your discovery on that. I mean, I'm thinking of an instance where we had a hiring manager who wanted to follow, wasn't Southwest Airlines, but wanted to follow Southwest Airlines when it came to interviewing for customer service people. And it kind of wasn't, nobody thought it was appropriate. So they hired us for the RPO side because they figured we could deal with the neurosis, right? So we all came in saying, yeah, this is too long and whatever. And then after we watched it and then we measured the retention rate, it was a better solve. So before I say no, like really get in there and there's that empathy, right? Try to understand, like you said, ask the whys, but watch it and then look at the metrics to see if it's our own thinking that's in the way.
Right.
Yeah. There was another question in there too, right, Jess?
Yes, they wanted to know if you are giving a candidate an assessment to complete, how much time should you give them to complete that assessment? That could vary depending on the type of assessment too that you're asking the candidate to complete. My broad, vague response to that would be 48 hours because you never know what the person has planned for that day. But again, it could vary. I always like to give the candidate some wiggle room to give them a good experience. So if I give them a deadline, I said, please let me know if this is not possible for you to do, hear what their explanation is and take it from there. You do have to have a bit of flexibility when dealing with the candidate because you do want them to have a good experience.
The other question was about the global HMs and very slow to respond. The cost of vacancy again, we'll put that, we'll send that out. We've sent it quite often, but I mean, when you find out that it's costing $1,300 a day for this position to be open, you think twice about not responding. Once you put, and they just don't get it, right? And I try not to get agitated about that because it's not their job, right? Their primary job is something else. You know, we had an instance where we were working with the cable company, the Virgin Islands, and they were down technicians. And this guy was literally on a moped going from island to island fixing the systems. He didn't have time to interview. We had to put a recruiter on a moped that followed him around to help him get there. I mean, that was one of the craziest ones we've ever had. But, you know, really trying to understand, again, you know, their position, but get them to understand yours. Those are some ways to do it by quantifying it. There was another question here too, and I knew we're out of time. It was about diversity. And it was an anonymous answer. I don't see it up here anymore, Jess. I don't know if you do, but I think the question was, how do you address diversity without creating more issues? That's a whole other topic. We do have some work on our website about it. Give me a private email if you want to send either Jess or I a private email. We'll be sure to answer it. If you want to direct it to Charlene, email us and we'll make sure that it gets to her too. Any closing words, Charlene?
No, this was great. Thanks for having me. I appreciate having this conversation. I think it was good.
Well, thank you so much for joining us. You're really doing a stellar job. Thank you for all of us.
Thank you.
Make sure we don't run out of blood. And, and that all these good causes get met. Hooray for the American Red Cross. Donate now.
Always need funds.
Jess, final words?
Just to echo a lot of what Charlene said, you know, having your recruiting team understand the business, build the trust with the hiring managers, and keep communication open is going to lead you to better hires faster. And again, Charlene, it was great having you on here. It's always, you know, a little mind-blowing to hear all the great things that the American Red Cross is doing. So thank you for that.
Thank you.
Awesome. Jess, thank you as always for your brilliant mind, the great work that you do here for us. I always appreciate that. Thank you to the audience. I know we've been picking up a momentum. I know we've been picking up a lot of followers and attendees. We appreciate that. If we can do anything for you, just let us know. We're always available via email and they'll get a copy of this, right, Jess, and the supporting docs. Great. Thank you so much. See you next. Oh, next month is May 29th. We're always on a Wednesday. We're always at noon, right for the holiday. And our guest will be Deb Kroger of, let me see if I can get the name right, Arvinas, which is an up-and-coming mid-market cancer drug that's pretty interesting, the work that she's doing over there. So join us and we'll see you then. Thank you so much.